sattvai prasidati. Translation by His Divine Grace, Lacey Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada. As soon as irrevocable loving service is established in the heart, the effects of nature's modes of passion and ignorance, such as lust, desire, and hankering, disappear from the heart. Then the devotee is established in goodness, and he becomes completely happy. Report by Śrīla Prabhupāda. A living being in his normal constitutional position is fully satisfied in spiritual bliss. This is the state of existence called Brahma-bhūta or Atma-nandi, or the state of self-satisfaction. This self-satisfaction is not like the satisfaction of the inactive fool. The inactive fool is in a state of foolish ignorance, whereas the self-satisfied Atma-nandi is transcendental to the material state of existence. The stage of perfection is attained. As soon as one is fixed in irrevocable devotional service. Devotional service is not inactivity, the activity of the unalloyed activity of the soul. The soul's activity becomes adulterated in contact with matter, and as such, the diseased activities are expressed in the form of lust, desire, hankering, inactivity, foolishness, and sleep. The effect of devotional service becomes manifest by complete elimination of these effects of passion and ignorance. The devotee is fixed at once in the mode of goodness, and he makes further progress to rise to the position of Vasudeva. Or the state of unmixed sattva or sudha sattva. Only in this sudha sattva state can one always see Krishna eye to eye, but by dint of pure affection for the Lord. The devotee is always in the mode of unalloyed goodness, therefore he devotee harms no one. But the non-devotee, however educated he may be, is always harmful. A devotee is neither foolish nor passionate. The harmful, foolish, and passionate cannot be devotees of the Lord. However, they may advertise themselves as devotees of the outward dress. A devotee is always qualified with all the good qualities of God, quantitatively and qualitatively. A devotee is always qualified with all the good qualities of God. Quantitatively, such qualifications may be different, but qualitatively, both the Lord and His devotee are one and the same. Bhaktivedanta Swami translation purport. The Canto 1, Chapter 2, Text 19. In Divinity and Divine Service. In the previous verse, Bhanu Maharaj read, the regular attending of the Bhagavatam class and serving the pure devotees, all that's troublesome in the heart is completely destroyed, and by doing service under the Bhagavat, then all the things that troublesome in the heart is removed. Loving service is established as an irrevocable fact. The next day appear in conscience that one is busy meditating on how to make arrangements for one's family. So here we see how service to the book Bhagavat and service to the devotee Bhagavat clears away all that's inauspicious from the heart. And then it says, bhakti becomes irrevocably fixed in the heart. And that happens. Next step is that passion, ignorance, is the effects of it, like lust, anxiety, hankering, and disappear from the heart. And then you become situated in goodness, and you become completely happy. How many want to be completely happy? Okay. Now you know how. These verses are very important for followers of Śrīla Prabhupāda. Why? Especially for us. When Śrīla Prabhupāda was in the harbor off from America, and he prayed to Kṛṣṇa and his Markina, Bhagavata Dharma, how he's going to spread Kṛṣṇa consciousness to this sinful place, America, to this Ugra place. Then remember these verses. And by hearing the Bhagavat, all the avadresu, all the inauspicious things are cleared from the heart. How, when that happens, one's purified from the passion and ignorance effects, situated in pure goodness. So that, Prabhupada, for 5-6 verses he quoted here in his prayer to Kṛṣṇa. This is my formula, this is what I'm going to do. I'm going to engage people in hearing and chanting the glories of Kṛṣṇa and serving the Bhagavat. Follow this process, and by your mercy of the Bhagavat, your mercy is going to work, and I'm going to become purified. So we find that this works. It doesn't only work in America, it works in Europe, it works in Malaysia, it works in Africa, it works in Australia. Works everywhere. Works in Russia. It's a universal process. It's not a material process. It's not dependent on nationality, race, religion. It works on anyone. Just like fire. Fire works. Totally non-sectarian. Will burn anybody. Doesn't matter what political party they belong to, what country, what religion. So this holy name and this Bhagavat Seva has a transcendental effect for everyone. The only problem is how to get people to try it. So you have the medicine that can save everybody from this disease. Say one of our devotees got dengue fever recently, dengue fever. And some of the dengue fever is actually very dangerous. They got this in the world today. Malaria has come back again, dengue. Then there's also AIDS, of course, is increasing. What if we had the cure? Do you want to give it out to everyone? What's a big pharmaceutical companies who want to put a patent on it and make a lot of money. Want to see everybody get the cure. But everybody's dying. Death is a permanent disease that everybody has in this world. And we have the cure for it. We're trying to convince people take the kid. We get people ourselves well. Let me enjoy life and then when I die, then I'll worry about that. So many different kinds, so much ignorance is there. So even somehow, even by accident, if somebody hears the Bhagavatam, they also get blessed. In Chennai, there was one life member. He came to see me, and his wife and his my inspiring disciple, sheltered disciple, and he once said, Guru Maharaj, I just want to tell you that actually I'm a very fallen person. You see, I'm a businessman. And I used to always go to Hong Kong, Singapore, Tokyo. And I'd always, whenever I go, I smoke, I drink. I'm a vegetarian though, but I do all these things and I regularly go, so I thought this is the modern way, acting very modern for all these things. My wife, she's very religious, so I drive her to the temple sometimes. She'd regularly come. I would sit out in the car and smoke while she's taking darshan. Sometimes I'd come in, also have a darshan. Sometimes I'd sit and hear the class. I thought this is not for me, it's okay, my wife wants to do it, let her do it. I'll do it later, it's not my time yet. So anyway. Then, he had bhakti riksha meetings in the house. And every month by rotation it would come into their house. Sometimes he would attend the bhakti riksha meeting just like sitting on the side like a host. But because the discussion is very interactive and very informal, so it's very easy to participate and listen. So he started to participate in that discussion. So after some few times of doing this, one day they were talking about how intoxication is putting the influence of ignorance in our consciousness. And how this intoxication is an obstacle in spiritual life. So then he said, well, if you take a coffee and tea, is that also a problem? So then the devotee told him, well, this type of stimulants are not good, better to just take the energy from the holy name. Then I was thinking, better not talk about my whiskey. Coffee and tea. Don't dare ask about whiskey. He said, somehow, now I just want to tell you, Maharaj, that now I'm chanting 8 rounds of japa. And I give it up intoxication. And I aspire in the future that also I can be initiated. But how this happened to me, I can't tell you. I don't understand it. Somehow it happened. Very, very happy. The devotees become very happy once they are Krishna conscious. But the materialists, they can't figure out why the devotees are happy. They don't do any things that make them happy. Like their idea of happiness is different kinds of sense gratification. And most of the things that give them more happiness are in a mode of ignorance and passion, which we don't do much. So then they can't figure out how is it that the devotees are happy. So they think, if I have to give up all these things, I'd never be happy. Therefore, I won't chant. And then they so it's not even good to sometimes inform people in the beginning about all the rules. Just get them to chant and hear. Well, Rupa Goswami said, Yena Tena Prakarena Krishna Manali Mosate. By any means, get people to chant, get them attached to Krishna. Once they're attached to Krishna, then you can introduce the rules and regulations. because then they're already standing at taste. So they can keep the taste and maintain it, and they need to know that they have to give up. These are tamasic things. So regularly attending Bhagavatam classes, it has a miraculous effect. And then here, this is the next stage. Performing devotional service. By hearing Bhagavatam for a while, and somebody develops this fixed devotional service. When someone is doing fixed devotional service, then while doing devotional service, this lust, anger, greed, all this material vipus, they start to diminish from the heart. More of goodness becomes prominent. But there's always a fight going on in our consciousness between the different modes. Right? And depending on our nature, on our previous karmas, on our purification, certain modes run out. And some people, they are just fixed in the mode of ignorance. Some are fixed in passion. Some are fixed in the mixed. Some are very much into goodness. So for spiritual life, it's better to be in goodness than in passion and ignorance. From goodness, you want to come to Sudha Sattva, pure goodness. So how these things leave the heart? We want to pull it out from our heart, it's very difficult. We cleanse it by performing this devotional service. Devotional service makes us happy. My brother, when I was a Dubhakta in the Montreal temple, or just moving to Shanghai, 5 years younger than me, he came to the temple in Montreal. And then after like 5 days, he said, "I gotta go back." I said, "Why? You're supposed to stay here 2 weeks." "No, I gotta go back right away." I said, "Why? I'm liking this too much." "I'm feeling so happy. If I get attached to this, then how will I go back home? They're not vegetarian. There's no all these things there. I won't fit in. I have to go quick before I get too." He said, "Wow, the Maya's really got it." I couldn't convince him to stay, so I guess he had all figured out that. From his mental point of view, sensual point of view, it's I'm not going to be happy. He's happy. He realizes he's happy chanting. Because so much identified with the body, he ran back. Sometimes when people start to chant Hare Krishna, you're frightened. They feel so happy. Why? They don't know how to adjust. Then one yogi in Mayapur, she was practicing Patanjali yoga system for 2 years in Pondicherry. Her guru passed away. She's from Switzerland. She came back to Mayapur. So she went actually to Calcutta. And when you land in the airport in Calcutta, every foreigner, they come up and say, Mayapur, all like taxi drivers. So she didn't know, it's okay, it's Mayapur. Like Krishna brought it right out to the holy nun. So I had some Swiss devotees, European devotees. I talked to her, and because she was already yogi, so they got her to do mantra meditation. That time it was the month of Baisakha, and we were doing the boat festival. After 2-3 days, I talked to her, and even by 3 days, she said, "Actually, I never felt happy." All 2 years I meditated, I didn't feel as much spiritual energy as when you know. But then she said, but then, how is it possible? It's too easy. You gotta work hard, you gotta struggle, you gotta suffer. It's too easy, you know, to have this and then you're gonna rain it, you know, because all the Maya bodies told her I'm gonna, it's very dry and suffering and meditation. How can you feel so happy so fast? So that put a doubt in her mind. It's too easy. So somehow, sometimes, this devotional service, you go like rocket. So quickly that people get frightened even. So much change. I was talking to one daughter of a devotee. She was saying, well, what if you're chanting Hare Krishna? You don't have a taste. But you're forcing yourself to chant. Because you know it's your duty. Your parents want you to do it. But really, you want to enjoy your senses. So I said, well, you are looking from which perspective? It seems to me you're looking from the mental platform. Lust is in the senses, the mind and intelligence. So we tend to look from the mental platform. We identify with the mind and the body. It's like some people say that I have a soul, rather than I am the soul. If you make the decision, this is what I want to do. I am the soul. I'm the boss here. I decide what I want to think. Again, my mind doesn't cooperate always, it's like I got a rebellious mind. But what I want to think, I decide. What I want to do, I decide. Based on what's good for me. Not what just my conditioning because of where I was born or what influence my peers are having on me or anything. What I want to do, using my talent, I decide. If you decide, I want to be Krishna conscious. And then you act like that. And your mind doesn't cooperate and so you tell your mind, why are you thinking of other things? To get to that spiritual platform, to get out of the mental platform, is very difficult. If we regularly chant, hear, engage in devotional service, eventually, gradually, we do get fixed and we start to get happy. But because people are fixed in this mental platform, somehow how to inspire the children to want to chant Hare Krishna. Not that your parent, not somebody's forcing or this, but they actually want to do it. They're inspired. They want to be devotees. They want to taste this. I asked one devotee recently, who said a similar thing, that why don't you, have you ever tasted the ecstasy of chanting Hare Krishna? We can talk to you about this happiness. You chanted Hare Krishna, tears poured from your eyes and your hair stand on end as your voice got choked up, gung, 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 when you chanted the holy name. Have you fainted in ecstasy, rolled in the ground in ecstasy, your hair stood all on end and you're chanting, go! Popsicle happiness or the ice cream, why not the super ecstatic happiness, the love of Krishna? Why not try for that happiness? Why Lord Chaitanya has come and shown this loving symptom so people can realize this happiness you can get. This is a much greater happiness than anything material. Even in the Bhāgavatam it says that the happiness of love for Krishna is so great. If you take the maximum happiness you can have in sense gratification on this planet, say you're the king of the earth, which no more kings of earth are, now all you can be is a Secretary General of the United Nations. I don't think that's very useful. But say you were the king of the emperor of the earth, you have all the sense gratification that earth had to offer in a religious way, that would be considered that your happiness for comparison's sake is equal to the number one. Compared to that, being a Gandharva, 10 times more happiness. Gandharvas have more happiness, more fun and games, more good times than the early human beings. And then, I forget all the planets, as you know, Chandara, Kinnara, you know, so Siddha, so many planets are there. Each one is 10 times more than the next. Then you get up to the Swarga, which is higher than all these other planets. By the way, it's interesting. So the Vedas talk about so many different types of living entities in this universe, higher than the human beings, lower than the human beings. But we're not seeing them, but they're there. So then we get up to Swargaloka. That's the devas. They're 10 times more. The residents of Swargaloka 10 times more than the other lower Upadevas and these other higher planets. But Indra, he's king of the Devas, he's like 100 times more than the other Devas. That means king of the earth would probably have 100 times more sense gratification than most people. But even here we just use it as one, that's his basic max unit. That's times 10 times 10 times 10 times 10 times 10 times 100 is Indra. Indra is like, you know, millions and millions of times more happiness. Less problems. But it says that Brahma is 1,000 times more happiness than Indra. So the happiness in Brahma look compared to the impersonal Brahman, it's not even a drop compared to the ocean. So all of the highest material happiness is not a drop compared to the ocean. Impersonal realization. And impersonal realization compared with Krishna Bhakti is not even the impression the amount of water a calf's hoof can hold. A little cup, a shot glass, something like that, compared to the ocean of happiness of Krishna Bhakti. So we're willing to give up. You can't even put it to the equation. We have many computer math experts here. One drop compared to the ocean, what would be the equation for that? And then times one cup compared to the ocean. I don't know if we have a computer big enough to calculate how much more happiness. We're giving up that happiness, right? For some tamasic, rajasic sense gratification, which is not even, it's not even equal to, it's might not even one, it's maybe 0.01 happiness level. Why don't we try for this spiritual happiness? Proceed with me, wherever I become completely satisfied. Next verse it says also, prasanna manasa, be happy mentality. That's from happy to more happy to more happy. It happens quite quickly that this feeling happy in the Lord of goodness. And from there it goes up higher and higher. When you get love of Krishna, it's so much higher than anything. It's inconceivable. We're missing, we're giving that up, right? So we can party with our friends, so we can sit in one of these taverns and get drunk. Come on, man. What? People are giving up the valuable jewels for just pieces of garbage. They don't know what a great opportunity. Lord Chaitanya, that's why I said Lord Chaitanya is Momo. Namo Mahabhadanaya. Mahabhadanaya. Super, super merciful. He's giving away. I mean, it's like, you know, you can't, he's giving away. We just calculate how much more valuable is Krishna Bhakti if you put into the, all the other happiness. People want to be happy, right? Why do people go to the resort here to be happy? Why do they play golf? Why do they go upstairs? Why do they go? They're trying to be happy. They're trying to, but they're doing their charvanas, charvananam, chewing the chute. They're just trying to squeeze the, some happiness out of these senses, same things, little different shape, little different, you know, we see a circus, yeah. Skating circuits, see this thing, see that. Tickle the eyes, see some fireworks, probably called fireworks, tickling the eyes. Yesterday was the Malaysian Games inauguration. We had some fireworks. We snuck a little bit. We tried to get the news. So many fireworks. Some of them. Okay, my way. These things give some kind of pleasure. We don't show fireworks to Krishna and Rath Yatras in South India, Manavaj, or anything. It's a Chennai Rath Yatra. As a service to Krishna. You can see also sometime in Mayapur we bring them to Bible. These things that they, you know, whatever, all the different kind of happinesses there are in material life, to a certain significance. And that jewel of spiritual happiness being given freely by Lord Chaitanya. Somebody started handing out $1 million checks. You get a lot of people wanting to take it, you know, from him. In Bangkok, a couple of years ago, I was passing through and they're giving out rice in some wat, in some monastery. And everyone who came would get a packet of rice and a dhoti or something that was sarang or something. And there was 5,000 people waiting at the gate. When they opened the gate, there was a big stampede. People running in to get a little packet of 4 kilos of rice or something, 2 kilos, 5 kilos of rice. Some people rushed. In such a way, in front, some people tripped and fell over, everybody ran over them. 11 people or 7 people were killed. For little rice. Imagine if people were giving out $1 million check, whoever wants it. What is $1 million compared to what Chaitanya is giving? People knew the value of what Lord Chaitanya is giving, there'd be a huge stampede. All the religions say we should love God, but how to actually get love of God is one of them easy thing. Even we follow the Bhāgavatam step by step by step, you have to go through a few steps here. This is now getting the board of ignorance and passion off from our getting happiness, then we go the next step, eventually. We really get love of Krishna after many, many steps. And Lord Chaitanya is giving it freely. Bhakti we get so quickly, don't even have to hear 1,000 Bhagavatam classes. Even a few days, someone's free because of Lord Chaitanya's mercy. We should appreciate how merciful the Lord is in trying to get His mercy. When Maya is there, Padishamrita is saying how they're the spoilers. Bhakta, Vinashyati, Pranashyati. Those things that kill Bhakti, we'll be discussing later today.
Maya is trying to take this jewel away from us. Easy come, easy go, right? You get somebody gets you a diamond worth of $50 million, and what's this? Oh, that's a piece of glass, I'll give you $100 for it. Oh, really, $100? Okay, it was real. You just gave $50 million for $100. It's that kind of a thing. We get the most valuable jewel, and then Maya sees that if that person stays with the jewel, she's out. Not going to be in the material world anymore. Come on, quick, she steps it up. Come on, I'll give you some, $100, I'll give you $950, what do you want? I'll give you a nice, girlfriend, boyfriend, come on, I'll give you something, what do you want, a better job? If you don't give it up, I'm going to give you trouble. She tries all the tricks she can. But she can't take it away from you. You have to be tricked to give it to her. You have to give it to her. So we should be, that's why we're in all the training. So don't get tricked. Don't give away your bhakti. Don't, have it just taken away from you. Give it away and leave it carelessly out, someone takes it. You have to either give it away or you have to just kind of leave it neglected and then walk away and someone picks it up. As long as you guard it, Krishna will help you protect it. Nobody can take your Krishna bhakti from you. If you just cling on the lotus feet of Krishna. That's why Srila Prabhupada said, we should cling on the lotus feet of Gaura Bhakta. Hanging. Don't let go. Somehow, Prabhupada used the system of Bhagavatam chanting, and it works. People start feeling it. Once they get the nectar, like Lord Chaitanya makes it work much faster than even normal. Some people, even minutes. Maybe somebody was a devotee in a previous life, and they see a picture of Krishna, they may start to cry. It may feel like some people, they might not have been devotees in the past, so it takes a little more longer time before they feel the spiritual bliss. But if they stick with it, by Lord Chaitanya's mercy, by mercy in the process of Bhagavatam, that works. So we should try to get the spiritual happiness. It's not that difficult. Make a good effort at it. If you haven't really tried, some people chanting one round for a long time and say, well, I don't taste this ecstasy. That's why we're trying to encourage them, put a little more effort into it, chant more rounds, chant better rounds, read the Bhagavatam, be absorbed. And the other thing is a question of absorption, of getting immersed in Krishna consciousness. It's a Bhagavatam yoga process. The yogis are meditating. And they go into samadhi after many, many lifetimes or many, many, many years. Then they get into that spiritual bliss. We don't have to learn all those procedures of yoga, but we need to get absorbed. We can get absorbed through a kirtan, so even a dancing in kirtan, or absorbed through chanting very clearly and hearing, absorbed by serving. Cutting the subjects for the, if we're thinking this is for Krishna, I'm offering it to you, cutting these subjects, don't cut your finger, please be careful. Then you can also be absorbed. The gopis in Vrindavan, they were churning the butter for Krishna, that's how they absorbed, thinking about this butter is for Krishna, he's going to eat the butter. Gopala Krishna, Govinda Krishna. Churning butter. So that we have to be absorbed in the service. So we need especially programs to get our children and our youth absorbed. So somehow, before, sooner than later, they can taste the spiritual bliss. Once they taste the bliss, then they'll be irrevocably fixed in devotional service. And by the age of 14, they have a taste of bliss. They get in the teenage years, it's going to be tough. Bigger fight, the senses are more wild. Still, game's not over. Prahlad, he felt ecstasy at age of 5. From his birth, he was feeling it. Constantly feeling it. It's not an age thing. You don't have to be a particular age to feel it. You can be 100 or you can be 5. It's a question of who can absorb their mentality. So it can be done gradually by regularly hearing the Bhāgavatam, hearing, chanting, attending, serving the devotees. Step by step, gradually can happen. Or someone can decide, I want to jump into the water. Sometimes you put your toe in the water, it feels cold, and you go in and get used to it, it's nice. If you want to get into the water up to our neck, you can dip in all the way. Totally immersed into Krishna consciousness, then you can feel. It used to be that we'd say you had to join the temple because everyone knew that if you joined the temple, you'd be fully immersed in devotional service because the temple commanders would keep you working from day to night, morning to night. And the Sankirtan leader and the head pujari and the temple president, so they don't give you any time. You have to be busy all the day. And it was thought that people living in a congregation, since they don't have that level of immersion, therefore, they're not going to taste the same ecstasy and they're not going to be as fixed up. But what we're trying to do is to train the congregation also, that they can also experience the same spiritual bliss, but that means that they have to push themselves. They have to engage themselves in devotional service. Some devotees are so fired up. They're preaching in Navhata, preaching in Bhakti Riksha, they're preaching in every spare moment that they have. Even though they're in the congregation, they don't have so many spare moments, but between the work and the family and the preaching, they have a full package. They're doing everything for Krishna. That they're feeling also the same spiritual happiness. See them, you can see them walking around smiling. You can see them with blissful faces. So it's not a thing that you have to be in a temple to feel this ecstasy. Temple's a good facility because there's so many, it's like being in the army military, it's very regulated. So, but if someone really wants to, they can space out in a temple also. It's not possible. But some good facilities are there. But you can also have the same thing, it just means that if someone has to create that environment, I get up in the morning, offer a little incense to my deity, take my showers, say my Gayatri, or chant my Ram, say a little puja for the deity, kiss my children on the cheek, you know, say hello to the wife, whatever you do. Start off the day a little bit better, everybody chant together. Take a little prasad, sit in the bus, someone asks me, can we chant japa in the bus while we're going to work? I hope so. What else are you going to do in the bus? Sing cinema songs. Sure we should chant japa, otherwise, you know. I try to tell that to the students, chant japa in the school bus. I said, no, what will my friends do? They think I'm weird. I'm not cool. You should make it, there's a story in American folklore of Huckleberry Finn and Tom Sawyer. Parents of Tom Sawyer told him he had to paint the fence. And then, so he made a plan, you know, he started painting the fence and he was smiling, oh, singing. Wow, this is so much fun. All the friends came around, hey, what are you doing? I'm having fun, I'm painting the fence, really. We're gonna go play. No, I didn't play, but I'm having fun, I'm painting the fence. Oh, this is great. Then they all got, what? Can we also do it? Okay. Yeah, pretty soon all his friends are painting the fence. Actually, he didn't think it was fun in the beginning. This way you get everybody, trick everybody to help paint the fence. They all came. Here we're not tricking anybody. Chanting Hare Krishna is fun. It is blissful. And if you can show consistently you're happier than the other people, then even the students think, hey, this person really has something. Everything's possible in being an action. Krishna consciousness is a realized process. It's realizing. It's for experiencing. It's like people say, well, look at, you know, I want to enjoy life now. When I die, I'll worry about it. Because they think that this is all for getting payment at the end of life. So they're worrying about enjoying now. But no, Lord Chaitanya made Krishna consciousness. You enjoy it now. You experience it now. You are actually feeling the transcendental happiness today. Tomorrow, just in a very short time, you can feel it. You don't have to wait till you die and you go to heaven and things like that. No, you feel experience of that transcendental bliss in this lifetime. All these verses are telling us that you are fixed in happiness. This is before you die. This is while you're living, while you're still here in this body, you're experiencing all this happiness. It's not something that you only experience, you know, like a post-dated check. I do everything faithfully at the end of life. When I die, I hope I get what's promised. Right? That's what most religions are. Everything is payday at the end. But we're showing that, no, devotional service is so transcendental, it's directly not different from Krishna. We are spirit. Krishna is spirit. When we serve Krishna, we are feeling the spiritual happiness now. In spite of having a material body, the bodily things are going on, but the happiness is coming from the soul. So we want people to realize this. To realize it, they have to get into it. They just put their toe in the water and it's a little bit cold. I don't know. In fact, they stop smoking eventually. I don't know how I get it. All these kind of mental things are holding us back. We need to dive in. Try it out. Get absorbed. If somebody fully gets absorbed in Krishna consciousness, it doesn't take years in yogas to start to experience some spiritual changes in the consciousness. But it depends how much we can absorb. Prabhupada said, I think that in one moment, if we really surrender to Krishna, we really cry to Krishna with our whole being, like a little baby cries for the mother when the baby is totally freaked out. If we could just like really cry for him, pick us up in 1 second. Just like the mother runs and picks up the baby. But we're kind of half-hearted in this. And we're not like fully putting us. I saw this one drama in Russia. And then Narada Muni gave a blessing. And then he said, okay, you can go back. And then Krishna kept coming and saying, I'm ready to take you back to God. And he said, well, I'm not ready yet. I want to get married first. I want to do this first. This rishi kept putting it off. I got to pay my debts first. I got to do that. I got to let my daughter marry. Something was always coming up. Wasn't ready to go back to God yet. We have so many things and these attachments. So how do we get rid of these attachments? And here, all these kind of subtle attachments, devotee ignorance and passion, which are binding us in the material world, can automatically get cleaned up just by performing this devotional service. You don't have to worry about all these things. You just chant Hare Krishna, you do the best you can, you try to avoid all the offenses and sinful activities. Chant Hare Krishna, do your duty as a, whatever your ashram is. And then the very grossest kind of attachments which can bind you in the material world, those roots which are tying you down, are very subtly purified. So that your relationships are on a higher level. You're going to go back to Godhead, your wife's going to go back to Godhead, your children, whatever, they go back to Godhead. Why leave somebody behind? 14 generations can go back. Don't have to worry. I do want to go back. So we hope the devotees see how this is a very mystical process, a very practical process. Get absorbed in it. Those who don't live in a temple, you have to create that environment where you get fully absorbed. You have to go sometimes, you know, there's too many times. Somebody can say, I'm doing all this service, why nobody else is doing this service? Because there's always that, you know, that's that kind of mentality. This other mentality that, you know, can I have more service? Going and asking, is there any service for me? What, how can I help? We're not competing, you know, like that, that who can do less service and get away with it. The point is, who can be more absorbed? What's your capacity? Someone else may have a limited capacity, you may have a greater for your capacity. Work up to your capacity, make your schedule, see how you can be fully absorbed in Krishna consciousness the whole day. How many minutes a day you're spacing out? Everything you do should be something you're connected to Krishna. In this way, if you're fully absorbed throughout the day, it's like there was one lady, she saw 3 hours in the middle of the day, I clean the house, the kids are in school, husband's in the work, I don't have anything to do, let me go out and preach. She go to door to door in the condominiums and find ladies to preach to. In this way, she set up something like a dozen bhakti riksha groups in different condominiums in the middle of the day. So they have to end the class here, it's time for breakfast. So, it's up to you. You see, being grihastha means more responsible. You have to make, nobody, there's no temple commander looking over your shoulder. What you do, how absorbed you are, how happy you are in Krishna consciousness is going to inspire your children. But they want to follow your example. To a large degree. Of course, children have a lot of influence from the friends. So that's why I was talking, I forgot to mention to the annual delegates conference that the bhakti, this Pandava Sena that we have in KL, somehow this program needs to be spanned throughout the whole of Malaysia and be really well organized, like they have in England. So many children, the youths in England are this Pandava Sena program that it has saved many of them from just going astray. Because they have devotee friends that they're associating with, playing with, chanting Hare Krishna with, to bring different programs with. Distributing prasada at orphanages, old folks' homes. Different programs to do together that just keep them busy. Self-instructive Krishna conscious way. We have lots of fun and taste a lot of Krishna conscious nectar. The kind of program, we need a program for all the different levels of our community so that everybody can get this taste of Krishna consciousness as early as possible. It's there for the having. Lord Chaitanya wants to give it to us. If we don't help people, facilitate for people young and old to taste it, then we will be doing a disservice for them. So we hope that during this festival everyone's getting fully absorbed. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. If you have any questions today in the afternoon, there'll be question and answer period. I think there's no time now. Thank you very much, Hare Krishna.
Thank you for watching our videos. Be sure to subscribe to our channel. We publish new videos every day, and don't forget to like and share our channel.